I feel immense pleasure in meeting all of the speakers. I thank the Professor Rangarajan for giving me the opportunity. And also I thank him for the nice introduction about me. So in computer field, we are learning. We are the people's every time we are learning. As per Rabindranath Tagore, the teacher not only teaches something to the student, but also learns many points from the students. That is the point. Actually, related to computer science, what we say, every time we should keep on upgrading ourselves. That is the important motive. So in this respect, the topic of today's topic is nothing but network security and authentication using cameras, then another one is by these are the two sessions which I am going to handle. So the first topic is authentication. Before that, what I would like to introduce, the abbreviation whichever I am going to use. One is IEEF, Internet Engineering Task Force. You can write it because all the abbreviations are coming in letter stage. You can note up if you need that. So KRP is KRPWG, KRPAS. KDC is nothing but Key Distribution Center. KRPAS Distribution Center. AS is nothing but Authentication Server. TGS is nothing but Ticket Branding Server. And KS is KRPAS Server. PKI is Public Key Infrastructure. These are the keys which we are going to use, abbreviations which we are going to use in our topic. The second one is QoS, Quality of Service. WSN is Wireless Sensor Network. SAP, SSL Single Socket Layer Authentication Protocol. SAP is Single Socket Layer Authentication Protocol. SPAN is Self-Powered RRF Network. SAN is Storage Area Network. PLA is Packet Level Authentication. NTP, Network Time Protocol. These are the in operation security, SRS, sender receiver synchronization. This is a very important thing. Lightweight directed access protocol, LDAP. LDAP which we are going to use as an abbreviation in our discussion. Now we talk about CareTrust. What is CareTrust? So it is a key authentication service. What we have here, the first part is network authentication protocol. It is a network authentication protocol developed in MIT in the mid-1980s. Then relax on conversational encryption. So encryption and decryption. In the case of encryption and decryption, CareTrust is an important point where it is helping you to make all the operations. So now it is available as open source, supported as a commercial software, and there are versions, two versions are available. One is version 4 and another one is version 5. So what is your CareTrust? It is a trusted third party. Third party is giving you encryption key, your key. So it depends upon the authentication. A person is supposed to give authenticated key. when a third party is involved, whether the person is perfect or not, genuineness is genuineness you are supposed to think about. So he is going to give you key. That is, in this respect, what we should understand, we should understand the thing called a symmetric key, asymmetric key. When you talk about symmetric key, when you are sending a message, when you are receiving a message, from India, from Kashmir, send 4 goods. What is the meaning? Meaning is nothing but send 4 AK-47. So a code word they are missing. When they are using code word, and it has to be encrypted and decrypted. There are so many things. So in that respect, what you want to do, you are supposed to have the key called as that symmetric key. That means both the keys are equal, same. Sender and receiver is having same key. Both the keys are same. While encryption same key, while decryption same key. You got the symmetric key. Then another one is when the keys are different, we are saying asymmetric key. Next, single sign-on multiple systems, cross-frame authentication, and you are supposed to make a distributed learning method. So here the KRWT is nothing but KRAS. IETF is Internet Engineering Task Force. Your Internet Engineering Task Force. It is of what is that your authentication function is of two things. One is message authentication is to be done at the lower level. What is that we are doing at the lower level? There must be some sort of functions producing an authenticator. The authenticator is having certain value, is authenticating the message. Before sending the message, he is giving some key to you. So that is what we know. Now here, it depends on the three things. One is message encryption, message authentication code, hash function. These three things mainly depends on the authentication functions. So something is missing. A picture. What is Kerberos? Kerberos is nothing but a dog which is having three heads. A dog which is having three heads. Just like a snake is having five heads. Snake is having seven heads. Snake is having so many heads. Like that, the dog which is having three heads is called as Kerberos. It's a Greek word. It's a Greek, as per Greek mythology. Many headed dog, the guardian of the entrance of caves. So here what is that we are going to do? You see here left hand side you are having Windows PC, then Unix PC, Mac PC, you are Linux PC, you may be having left hand side. Right hand side you are having Kerberos key distribution center, then your telnet. Your telnet or FTP server, file transfer protocol server. So what you are going to do? First you are going to make a ticket request. Second one, ticket is sent. Third, what you are doing, service ticket is requested. Third one. Fourth one, service ticket is sent. Then fifth one is ticket is presented. And sixth one is open channel for the internet. So this picture, if you want to understand this picture, we should go to some other thing. You see here, there is a client, there is a key diffusion center. So what is happening? A request is sent to the authentication server, then the response is coming. Then the next stage, what you are having? You are having ticket granting server. That ticket granting server, for that you are supposed to send request, then you are supposed to receive response. So it is checking in the database. In the database, what is there? Whatever you are, in the database, to check the key. Then it will serve to the person. So similarly, the application server, you are sending a request, then you are receiving a request. Now go to the picture, now in this respect. See here, first two things you are making a request, then second two things the service is provided. So that is the difference. Now you see the picture, you will be understanding this. Now in between, this authenticate server is referring to database. After referring to database, the ticket granting server is giving the request. The second slide is what is that? This is nothing but your IP addresses. You are having web server, then you are having client, you are having KDC, key distribution center. Now this is a Kerberos technology. As per mathematics, you know what is that? Alice, Bob, and other three people are there. All the 3 days you are learning all those things. So who is that intruder? Is it Bob intruder or Alex intruder or some other person? Okay, the intruder is many to this one. So the logic is nothing but
one, first one you are saying bar comma password. Second one, A stands for authentication server. It's a request. Then third one is nothing but create. You are creating ticket granting ticket. TGT stands for ticket granting ticket. Then KDC stands for
Key distribution center.
Key distribution center is sending message to you, giving response. As a fourth one, authenticate server is giving a response. Then fifth one, local host is decrypting, and finally bar is getting the thing. So that is how the picture is working up. Now you can see the same picture is activated in this form. First one you are getting, second one is AVT. Then third one, where is the request service ticket, fourth one return service ticket, and you are checking the, what is the fifth one is getting service ticket, sixth one validating ticket. The picture is represented in different form. Now we have another picture. User is here, the KDC, Key Decision Center. You are having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All the 6 operations is represented in this form. Now there is a picture. What is this picture? Left side you are having client, right side you are having key distribution center. In between, the operations are noted down. First one you are having number 1, principal key, number 2, TGT request, ticket granting ticket is requested. Then third one, encrypted TGT, session key is sent to the set here. And fourth one is TGT, ticket granting service, and service ticket is requested once again. Then fifth one, service ticket and service session key is transferred to the client. Then next sixth operation, service ticket is requested. Then seventh operation, establish service session. Complete. This process is over by the seventh point. So now this is the simple picture which makes you the what is the AB and CD, EF and EG, finally get. So this so many operations are noted down here. Now this is the Kerberos ticket. This is the general form. First one you are having the version of file, server name, flags is noted up, sessions key is noted up, client pin and client name, validity state time, validity end time. So this is the format of the Kerberos ticket distribution system. Now this is the picture which is giving you the clear idea about the KDC or LDAP. So LDAP is introduced with your, what is the explanation of LDAP? Lightweight distribution.
Authentication
portal. Right, good. So now there is another picture. The request TGT goes here. Now TGT sessions key is coming. The request plus authentication is made. Fourth one is ticket plus sessions key. So the alias and the operation is made between alias and the key distribution KDC. This is a sequence diagram. What is the benefit of sequence diagram? Sequence diagram is depending on mainly timing. It notes down each and every time. So what is the operation? When an entity or the operation is made, that operation is noted down. See here, this is the one is first operation, second one, third operation, fourth operation, fifth operation, sixth one, seventh one. So this one, the sequence diagram gives us the timing. Which operation is the first one, which operation is the second one, and how many entities are there, how it will be added. So now this is another Kerberos diagram. Now you see single sign-on Kerberos. What we have here, we have user desktop, then we have client, then we have Microsoft Active Directory, then what is the SAP news vertical, is that Java, then SAP news NetWeaver, SAP NetWeaver, then AS above. So the operations are shown here, how this SAP is to be executed. Now this is the simple process of login. When you are doing login and process, the encrypted password is sent to KDC, the master ticket is sent once again. Then when we are doing request operation, what is happening? A master ticket is sent to the KDC and the token, service ticket is sent back once again. Now that service ticket is checked with the database server. This is a complete operation of the key distribution authentication server. So anyhow, this PowerPoint will be transferred to you. This is another form of ticket granting services.
and also in other form of ticket granting services. So now the theory part comes into effect. So a SAP net weaver business client NWBC is a rich user interface design. Now what is that it will do? What is that it will do? The business client, it is acting, it is going to send message, it is going to receive the message.
Your server is read B. Each domain is having its own activity. Server is acting in different way, client is acting in different way. But both the things are connected. A server may be connected with 10 clients. Server may be connected with 100 clients. Server may be connected with so many clients. But the server is giving all the services, whereas the Kerberos KDC is going to distribute the keys.
So the difference between version 1 and version 4 and version 5 is here. Encryption system is depending on that. It works on the internet protocol and it is working on the basis of byte ordering, and it is mainly based on the lifetime of the ticket.
When the ticket is granted, it will be saying 30 seconds valid or minute valid.
So the ticket is having lifetime.
So authentication is forwarded and inter-ring authentication.
This is a DES. So you are having triple DES algorithms here. One is DES encryption, top is DES encryption, below is decryption, triple DES. So which is of 168 bits. So P4 is restricted to a single view, whereas P5 allows inter-ring. That is the difference between P4 and P5, version 4 and version 5. Version 4 is restricted to single view. Version 5 is it can have contact with many views.
Have a KDC on your network and we have compressed applications running on your watch operating system. Your restrictions are there.
Then this distributed set of servers that maintains a database, you are maintaining database, and also we use SIME. What is SIME?
Multi-purpose mail extension.
MIME. IP security, SSL,
secure certificate.
So now what we are having a distributed set of server that maintains database. The same thing is repeated, I think. Yeah. Now this is the X5.9 format. When a key is distributed and we are supposed to encrypt and decrypt, that is over. Now what we are supposed to issue a certificate. When you are willing to issue the certificate, the certificate will be granted based on the format. What is your format? One is question, certificate serial number, algorithm, parameter, is your name, not before and after. That means before so and so date, after the so and so date.
Because when a check is given in the bank normally, the check is valid for 6 months, something like that.
Similarly, here you are having period of validity, that means the timestamp will be there. It will be the time. Lifetime of the thing when the 30 second or 1 minute. So not before, not after, it is validation is done. Subject public key is noted here, signature. So this is the format of the X509. So how to obtain a certificate? You are CA stands for authority. What authority? Authority. So any user with access to the public key of CA can recover the user public key that was certified.
So it has to be certified. Who is certifying?
Third party.
Third party is certified. That third party is nothing but Kerberos.
Now reasons for replication. The user's secret key is assumed to be compromised. User is no longer certified by the CA. The CA certificate is assumed to be compromised. So here the final thing is nothing but you are having one of that. You are supposed to do message encryption.
Message authentication code,
then hash function, Kerberos.
These are the things which we are summarizing into this particular session.
So in this, some of the slides are once again repeated. I'm sorry for that. So what is that authentication application? That is subtopic. What is that authentication application? So we are supposed to use this mighty use things are Kerberos and X5.9. But whereas in this session, what I would like to say is
out what is the certification issuing, it is having more than 30 flags.
So that flags we are supposed to discuss. So authentication applications are, it is a private key authentication service, and X509 is a public key directory. The Kerberos picture, then developed in MIT, it is based on symmetric encryption, the same thing. So it is secure, reliable, transparent and scalable.
What is memory scalable? Scalable is nothing but when you have 100 clients, you may be having 1000 clients. Whether the Kerberos can supply the key to all the 1000 clients, it may be having 10,000 clients. So when you are having more than 10,000 clients or 100 clients, 1000 clients, when now it depends upon the number of clients, when you say that, it is you are saying that scalable.
When you have more number of clients. See, the trusted, it is a trusted third party client, third party operation, and it is using DES, all the things in Salon is repeated. Ticket branding service is repeated, the same feature is repeated. Read 1, read A repeated. Yeah.
This is a nonce. What is that? You are having, you are creating one time pack, one time password. One time password. When the one time password is sent? For maintaining secrecy. And one time password is most trusted and most reliable and most the performance is better. Performance is better because it will link only to certain behaviors. One time password.
So nonce is nothing but a cryptography, a nonce is an arbitrary number that can be used just once time, one time only. So after that it will be removed. So now here this is the, to create the ticket, so we are having so many things. What is that here? Ticket operations are done as per RFC 4120. The most common values are this one. These values are, we are supposed to learn. So what is this thing? The ticket options are stored in 32-bit value. So this session is particularly deals about the 32-bit. What is the first bit? 0 is resolved. Bit, this is the bit number, this is the flag name, this is the description. 0 is resolved. First bit is forwardable. Ticket is forwardable. 2, forwarded. What is that it is doing? It indicates either that TDT has been forwarded or that a ticket was issued for a forward TDT. Third one, proxible. Proxible tells the ticket granting service that it can issue ticket. So it is informing to the ticket granting service whether it can issue this ticket or not. Fourth one, proxy. This indicates that the network address in the ticket is different from the one in the PTT used obtained by the ticket. Fifth one, allow post data. Post data ticket should not be supported. Sixth one, sorry. Post data ticket should not be supported in KIO. Seventh one is invalid. Eighth one, renewable. Used in combination with the end time and renew time fields to cause the tickets with a lifelong status. The ninth one, initial. It indicates the ticket was issued using the authentication service. Tenth one, pre-authentication. So it indicates the client was authenticated by the KDC. So ordinarily it is indicating to the what is that? The KDC is authenticable person. That is the fifth, tenth point. 11th one, 11th bit is opt hardware author. This flag was originally intended to indicate that hardware supported authentication was used during pre-authentication. And the 12th bit, transistor policy check. So whether the KDC must not check the transistor domains or service or cases, it is checking the KDC. 13th, OK as delegated. So it is saying KDC KDC giving response is OK. 14th, request anonymous, KDC not using this plan. So this plan is not used. 15th, name can canonical. In order to request reference, the Kerberos client must explicitly request the canonicalized KDC option for AS request, authentication server request or TGS request. So this is the 15th bit. 16th to 25th bit is unused. Then 26th bit is disable transistor check. So by default, a KDC will check the transistor field of a TGT against the policy of local people. Then 27th bit, renewable voting. So the opinion indicates that a renewable ticket will be acceptable or not. That it will say. Then 28th, BMC ticket in sky. There is no information. 29th, unused. 30, renew. The renew option indicates that present request is renewable or not. So there are 32 keys are, 31 is valid. So there are 32 keys are acting in this respect to issue the ticket granting services. Each bit is taking its own responsibility and roles. Based on that, your ticket will be valid or not. Now this is the simple expired finance line. It's already completed. Now you see, these are the important points here. Vessel 1, 2, 3, issued by a certification authority and serial number unique with CK. Signature algorithm is identifier. So then issue of X509, name is CA. Period of validity starting and ending date will be there. Then subject public information algorithm parameters, all these things will be issued. Issue your unique identifier will have what is the vessel 2. And V3 is extension fields are given in version 3. So this is the certificate we have seen already. X509. Certificate revocation is of the theories. And so the authentication procedures are depending on mainly this point is very important. It depends on the one-way authentication, two-way authentication, three-way authentication. So these all the things are using public key as signature. So these are the three parts. Messages, one, first one, second one, one way authentication, two way authentication. So the one way authentication is nothing but used to establish identity of A, that message is from A. Message was intended for B. So from A, the message will transfer to B. That is your one way authentication. Whereas two-way authentication, the message will pass from A to B, then B once again B to A. The message will be received by the A. That is called as two-way authentication. What is three-way authentication? From A, from allies it goes to Bob, then Bob to allies, then once again allies to Bob. Once again, allies to Bob. So the three-way authentication will be complete circuit. It will complete the total circuit. By that, we will be understanding there won't be any intruder. This is a public key infrastructure. This is a email security. So the diagram shows your PKI users, PKI management entities, what we have a certified CRR repository, certified CRR retriever, MTLDK, where it is starting, where is it starting?
MTLDK.
Then here certificate publication, certificate CRR publication, certificate authority, cross certification, CRR issuer, CRR publication, certificate authority, then registration, initialization, certification, key pair recovery, key pair update, revocation request. All the operations are run there. Now this is the email security. Your confidentiality is important, authentication is important, then message integrity. Then next important topic is pretty good privacy. I think you have learned this thing on the 4 days. Anybody put this topic? So what is your pretty good privacy? It is widely used for secure email. Then what is it developed by Zimmerman and selected as best available crypto algorithm? Your pretty good privacy. On Unix, PC, Macintosh, other system it can be used. Originally it was free, then later I guess money is involved in that. Then sender creates message. Second option is using SHA algorithm. SHA algorithm to generate 160 bit of hash message. And third party signed hash with the RSA using sender private key and is attached to message. Your RSA algorithm is involved, so algorithm is combined as a hybrid. Then fourth point is receiver uses RSA with sender's public key and decrypts the return hash code. Then fifth part is receiver verifies the message. So this is your PG, pretty good operation. There are five steps are there and PGP. So it can be used both services and same message. And we are creating signature and attached to the message. Encrypt both message and signature. What is that you are going to do? You are going to apply the compression algorithm. This is a zip compression algorithm you are going to use, apply this one. So when using PGP, you will have binary data and it will be sent. Your PGP must encode raw binary data into printable ASCII characters. Your PGP email is using 64 bit address and it is 3 bytes to 4 printable character and also appears on CS. Your PGP operation summary, file is stored in X and convert from RAID 64 bit 64 bit. Signature is required, checks, generate signature, then compress Z of X is stored in X, then confidentiality required. So if yes, it is encrypting, no means it is coming this way and it is converting RAID 64 into X, stored in X. Go to that side, right hand side, then RAID 64 bit is stored in X and it checks confidential required. Yes means earlier if you did decryption, now you use encryption, now you should do decryption. And then decryption algorithm is written, steps are written, then it is decompressing, decrypting, then it goes to your decompress. Do you want to decompress? Then yes means you are signature from X, verify the signature, then after that it comes. So now the message is sent as encrypted and message is decrypted. This is the steps for pretty good privacy. So it is having a sessions key. Your DES is 56 bit and 128 bit is your ID algorithm, 168 bit is triple DES. So this is the number of bits. DES is nothing but 56 bit. 56 into 3, how much? Your triple DES is 168. So that means now PGP message format is here, your content is here, operation is there, sessions key is component, signature, message. So it is having key ID, sessions key, timestamp, key ID, leading to two tickets, message address, file name, file stamp, data. So these are the things. Now message is generated, this is this picture, and message reception, then key management, these are the key management rules, then SMIME, your multi-purpose internet mail extension, then RFC is done and SMIME functions are mounted. And what we are supposed to do, we are supposed to do RSA along with MD5 algorithm. So algorithm with MD5 you are supposed to do it. And so range of content types. This is a certain authority. So here you are having class identity checks usage. One is name and email check. What is that you are using? Web browsing email. Below that you should see. Number 2, enroll and check email. Number 3, ID documents. So now this is the summary. These are the topics that are completed.
Thank you. Just in the second session. First session is Kerberos, second session is your pride box.
So why five parts are required? The five parts we require to predict the virus. How many types of virus are there? Trojan horse virus. Next time. Stone virus. Then antiviruses. Who creates virus? Programmer is creating virus. When the program is creating virus, what we want to do is we want to protect the system. The system is nothing but through server, through internet, all the virus is entering. When you use floppy disk, virus is created. When you have hard disk, the virus is entering. When you are using pen drive, the virus is coming through that. When you are using internet, the virus is coming. When you are opening a file, email file, virus is coming. Any document when we click on, the virus is coming. The person who invented the virus was an accident. The game was created. The same game was played by many people. So when they play 50th time, automatically they made it as what is that? The screen should go off. In such a manner, they have created a virus. So, in our system, we can create a virus using batch file. When you write batch file, del:\del:\c:\del:\, what will happen? It will delete all the content in the C directory. When we write in c:\\/while, what it represents is nothing but before formatting C drive, the dask command, yes or no prompt. So when we use /while, it won't ask your prompt whether I should format C drive or not. It won't ask. What it will do, it will erase all your C drive. So when we teach to our student will make what is that? Fun of us. So as a batch file, the virus is created and sent along with a file which they are attached. And sometimes what we do, sometimes the code will be repeated. That is a ream of virus. It is called as ream virus. When we write 100 lines of program, when you send it, 10 lines of program will be copied once again. So what will happen, the repetition is coming. It is called as ream of virus. That can be identified. And while identifying file, main thing is what it will happen, the size of the file, any file size will increase when it is affected by virus. That is one part. Second part, how to detect the virus? We can check the stream of bits. That stream of bits will be changed. Check the pattern with the existing pattern. That is how we can write the antivirus. Checked with the existing pattern. If the same pattern is repeated, same pattern of stream of bits is repeated, that means that particular file is affected by virus. So we have a template. We have templates, so many templates, or samples. Samples of bits of stream. It goes and checks in the database. Then it is finding that virus is affected. And it will clean the virus. How many types of cleaning? One is you can clean the virus. Then you can quarantine the virus So you have plenty of virus things on that. And the, in that, before that virus, we just run through what are the viruses on that. Firstly, it's a sample only. But then my topic is nothing but firewalls. What is your firewall is going to do? It is going to stand or protect the virus system before attacking the virus. That is your firewall. So you have what is the hardware, you have software. We can have hardware protected firewall, we can have software protected firewall. There are two things we can have separately.
I have not copied the virus, okay.
So the outlines of firewalls are what we are having. We are supposed to identify firewall characteristics and study types of firewall and firewall configuration. Now we should have a trusted system. What is trusted system? If the system is virus free, we call it a trusted system. And so the viruses are Trojan horse. Trojan horse is one of the virus. What is Trojan horse? In the olden days, between two countries there was a fighting. And in that fighting, what they did? The king prepared a big horse. Then in the horse stomach, he planted every soldier inside. And he told that this horse will be given as a present to the enemy. Enemy king. In such a manner, they have transferred all the complete horse. What happened after reaching the particular opponent king place? All the soldiers in the stomach, they came out. They started fighting with the king. They captured that country. That was the Trojan horse story. It was happened. So similarly, with the file, the virus will be attached, sent to you. There after receiving, when you are opening the file, the Trojan horse will come out. All the soldiers will come out, it will affect you. That is called as Trojan horse. Here you have, what is it? The system you are having server that side. In between your virus, what is it? The firewall is protected. Firewall is, like a wall, it is protected. Now this is the firewall architecture. What is it? We have post firewall. This is another post firewall. You have your IP addresses. You are having IP addresses of subnet. Then internal firewall is there. Main border firewall once again. Screening router firewall. Then public web server. External DNS server is there. You have your HTTP. So what will happen? The firewall is protecting you. Now here, you are having so many virus, Slammer, Code Red, Nimda virus, Napa virus. Can we load two virus, three virus, antivirus in our system? At a time, it is better to load only one antivirus. Because when you load three or four antivirus, what will happen? Your system will be slowed down. Even if you load only one antivirus, your system will be automatically slowed down. Because each and every time, each and every file, it is going to check whether virus is affected or not. So it is slowing down. When you are loading two antivirus will create another virus. So that is not better. So there are Slammer, Code Red, Nimda, Slammer. There is a firewall. There is antivirus. Any one antivirus load, then intrusion prevention is done. Your business is safe. That is your firewall. Now your company's firewall security, you want to protect yourself from hacking. So this is the firewall standing here. Now this is the industrial network, this is the corporate network. So what is there in the industrial network? Your industrial system, your waterfall. Next one. Your corporate network you are having replica of system you are having. So your replication is to be repeated. In between you are supposed to install your firewall. So there is a email pushing your email. The virus is coming through that. The data is streaming. Firewall is protecting all these things. As I told you, there are two type of fibers are available. One is software fiber. So that means it is through floppy they are reading, or the software is created, it is going to check. With the hardware, you can install a, what is that, the hardware component into your computer. Then in computer itself you can install the part. The part is shown here. You can install the part. That will prevent from attacking your virus. So it is a fiber. So the cost is varying. Then their cost is varying. The cost always varies depending on time. So now what is that you are going to initiate for computers locally share folders. Then in the software fiber, firewall may interface with the local networking sharing. And the cost is varying once again. So what is that you are having? A part is installed. But now there is a virtual private network. Through virtual private network, what is it you are going to do? You are going to access the you are having a system of 4GB RAM. You want to run with the 16GB RAM. So what you want to do? You are contacting virtual private network, you know, is supplying you. And per year you may be paying money. You may not have all the configuration in your system or software, you do not have it. You can contact a person who is having higher configuration. You can run your code from here. So there is a virtual private network. The person is providing all the facility. There is another picture called what is your firewall. See, this is the development side, that is the production side, then staging side over here. So your presentation pair, application pair, data pair. These three things are there. In between your firewall is standing. So you have your switches and SDN controller, firewall provision, firewall placement, all these parts are showing what is the role of your firewall. So this is a clustered zone, that is the external. What is a clustered zone? When we go to Australia or other like European countries, we are intimated first, they are intimating us, you should stay in this 3 kilometers area only. If you go outside, what will happen? They will find your skin color, then they will beat you with the stones. Whether you are highly bone condition or not, they don't know about you. So that is a zone, protected zone. Similarly, here your computer, 10 computers are firewall protected, or 100 computers are firewall protected. This is called as trusted zone. Your external access, you are going to contact with the external access through internet. So this is a back-to-back firewall. Your premier network, internet, then external firewall, internet. So you are providing two firewalls. There is a honeypot. Honeypot is also, what is that? It's a computer security mechanism. Honeypot is a computer security mechanism. What it is going to do? It is going to detect, deflect in some manner, counteract attempts at unauthorized use of information. It is once again a similar form of your firewall. So a picture is shown here. There is a honeypot is shown. Honeypot is shown. Firewall, where is the firewall here? Where is the firewall here? Honeypot itself is acting as a firewall. Now this is a, what is that you have, what is this? You are having an enterprise. In that enterprise, how the firewall is protecting you. Now you see, the firewall is filtering and you are noting down what is that IP packet, GRE, ESP packet, outer IP packet, other internet frame, the pass by firewalls, you are having HTTP, TCP IP, outer IP packets. So here, below it shows that legacy VPN, then what is that? Now this is a virtual machine. VM stands for virtual. There are plenty of virtual machines. You are having gateways, you are having NIC network interface cards. Then the what is it, power shell, your distributed firewall manager is noted down, host 1 and host 2. So this is another picture which is acting as a gateway, and the firewall is noted down here. This is a signature extraction, and your IP reputation, web reputation, file reputation, email reputation, all these things. And here this is the specialized enterprise branch of firewall, and it shows what is your port numbers, along with IP address,
your ISP service provider, NetLabs. In between firewall is there. And this is the firewall thing, secure reliable connectivity through IP security of IPv6 or IPv4. So the customer data center is content and secure. So it is a cloud environment. For the cloud environment, this one. Then this is the traditional firewall, and this one is Polo Auto next generation firewall. Next generation firewall, they are thinking about it. In that what is secure? The second part, top part will take care of all this in DNS. It goes to Polo Auto NG and DNS, which is setting outside. Then two input, one output. So that is the next generation firewall they are thinking about. And this is a malware. This is for the malware. And these are the packets. Initial packet processing, security flow processing, application, the security policy, so all the things. And this one is nothing but your packet receiver, packet sender, your FPGA accessing. The path is shown, how the packet is transmitted from one place to another place. These are the visualization services platform. Through Visualize Service platform, this particular feature is showing how the accessing is done. This is the IP security package, and packets are discarded, sometimes packets are being transferred. So the firewalls are first generation firewall, second generation firewall, third generation, fourth generation, fifth generation. In the first generation, packet filtering is done. Second generation, a proxy firewall is created. That means firewall like firewall. You are creating a proxy firewall. That is acting. So then third one is stateful firewall. Fourth one is nothing but your first generation, second, third generation is combined. That is nothing but fourth generation. It is a dynamic factor, packet filtering. So the firewall is effective. What you want to do? It is going to save you from the threats. That is why you are using firewall. Now, information system undergoes steady evolution. What is the aim? You want to establish controlled link. When you want to establish controlled link and your system, you want to have the self-protected zone that you want to have. For that, you are installing firewall. Before that, you are supposed to design the thing. The goals are, what is that? When you are having traffic, more traffic may be there. What the firewall will do? It will identify each and every packet. It will scan the packet. It will identify stream of bits. When the stream of bits is repeated, it is going to stop. There is a virus is there. And when the packet is received, when the packet size is more, it is going to identify that the packet is containing virus. Then next, if another packet is coming, it is identifying what is that the repetition of code in many places. Then in that case, it will identify the what is that the repetition of code is there. That is why stop the viruses are. These are the simple technology. This is firewall is doing that. There are many technologies are there. These are the design goals. And the firewall characteristics are service control, direction control. Then user control, behavior control. These are the firewall characteristics. And you have three types of firewalls are there: packet filtering, application level gateways, circuit level gateways. Then here the internet and private network is there. So it is going to filter the packet. Packet filtering by the router, and it is to be set up. So the advantages of firewall is nothing but simple. Transparency, high speed. That is why you want to use the firewall. What is the disadvantage? The packet filtering rules is clumsy. Each and every packet when you are checking, each rule, the virus creator is following different system, different methodology to inject the virus. In that case, each time, the firewall may not identify. That is the thing. And
the performance of the system will be slow. When the fiber is installed, so the performance of the system will be slow. Why not? Because each and every packet it has to check. It has to open the packet and identify the bit of streams are there or not. So all the work it has to do. So that is why it is slow. The types of fiber, it is made IP address spoofing. It is the creation of IP with a false secure IP address. So false IP address will be created, so it is called as spoofing. And it may be source routing attack, tiny fragment attacks. So here application gateway, there is a outside host, there is an inside host. You are having telnet, FTP, SMTP, HTTP. These are gateways. So when the gateways are there, and with the gateways what you can do, you can create your proxy server also. So advantages is higher security than content filter. Only you to scrutinize few allowable applications. That means your only allowable application can scrutinize. It need not scrutinize all the packets. And disadvantage is nothing but additional processing overload. So the processing overload is more than traffic filtering router. This one is the important. This is a circuit gateway, what you are going to have outside host, then inside host, then circuit level gateway is here. It is going here, it goes in and out, so it checks each and every packet. Circuit level gateway, so it is enough basin host. So now the important. So this is a simple example for the single home host. You are having internet, packet filtering router is here, information server, private network host, basic host is essentially this one. So fiber configurations, then greater security, application level, all these things you are talking about, different access. This is a screen and what is it, a screened host firewall system. This is a subnet firewall system. So in this advantage is three levels of defense got intruders. At the whenever the intruder is coming, each packet will be checked thrice. So this trusted system, implementing trusted system technology. So what is the trusted that area, particular area? You are saying that it is completely firewall and virus is protected and the systems are trusted. So here there is no virus, that's how you are going to make it. So there is something called as data access control. How you are making through access, what is the access matrix? Here class 1, class 2, program 1, program 2. You are going to read and execute. Read, execute. If the virus is found, you are going to terminate the process. Or you are going to do three work. One is quarantine the virus, or clean the virus, or delete the virus. So that is why you are going to read. And there is access and control. And next one is the compatibility. And this is a trusted system. Multi-level security you are going to provide. And this is your reference monitor concept, multi-level security. And this is once again a reference monitor. These are the characteristics that you will verify with your security. This is a Trojan horse. So Trojan horse is nothing but it is going to create virus, stays in your file itself. Then as and when it comes out, it spreads. It is creating so many things. And the virus itself can write another code. Virus itself can execute on its own. Virus can run on its own. So when it is running on its own, like what is that, MLR? And the internal is, yeah, right. Robo is creating another robot. Robo is creating 10,000 robots. Robo is creating like that. Your Trojan mask, your virus is going to create another virus, 10,000 of virus. It will embed it to your file. So the firewall system is simply protected. This is the main measure, Trojan mask. Now your next generation firewall. This is the next generation firewall.
is the what is it we are having? Intrusion prevention, web proxy, antivirus, web filter, sandbox, SSL inspection. All the things is the next generation. Next, these are the recommended reading.
System administrator's job. Especially when the user has passwords defined in many places for many services. And what about protecting those passwords? Even encrypted passwords can often be cracked. Well, that's why the folks at MIT developed Kerberos. To make it easy for administrators to manage passwords by storing them centrally, enhance security by ensuring no clear text passwords are transmitted, and allowing users to access different services with the same password. Having passwords in a central location will obviously make them easier to administer. But how are services authenticate users when they don't know the user's passwords? Why don't we just limit ourselves to using protocols that encrypt the passwords? That's safe, right? Well, yes, encryption is a good way of protecting our authentication, but consider the following scenario. Our hero is relaxing in his local cafe, which conveniently offers free wireless internet access. When he boots his computer, it makes a DHCP request for several configuration parameters, including the IP address of a DNS server. An evildoer at the same cafe happens to be running a DHCP server on his computer. This DHCP server distributes information pointing clients to his fraudulent DNS server. This imposter DNS server has fake entries for many common email servers, all pointing directly to, you guessed it, the evildoer's mail server. You may know this is spoofing, and here's why it's bad. If our hero tries to log into his mail server with a non-authorized name and password combination, the hijacker's mail server probably won't be able to log him on, but it can harvest his name and password to be used for other fraudulent purposes. Even if the password is encrypted, chances are the poacher can decrypt it pretty easily using free tools from the internet. So what we need is a way to keep passwords off the network in the first place. And that's exactly what Kerberos does. Let's take a look at how Kerberos protects your passwords by keeping them off the network. And at the same time, makes management easier by centralizing the storage of the passwords. To begin with, the name Kerberos gives a clue to the way Kerberos works. In Greek mythology, Kerberos was the vicious three-headed dog that guarded the gates of Hades. In network authentication, Kerberos creates a realm of three players that collectively guard your network. The Kerberos client, the Kerberized service, and the key distribution center, or KDC. We'll see how these three players work together to provide secure authentication with all the passwords stored in a single location and not transmit clear text passwords during the authentication process. And from a user point of view, access to each service is transparent. In fact, the user can access all the services by logging in only once. Users and services in Kerberos realm are known as principals. And each has its own secret encryption key stored on the KDC. The system administrator creates these keys and they are shared only by the principal and the KDC. Each principal trusts that a packet encrypted with this key must come from the KDC. The KDC also has a private key that it shares with no one. This key ensures the integrity of the authentication process. Here's how it works. We'll use blue for the user's key, red for the service's key, and green for the KDC's key. It's easy to see that the KDC can encrypt a packet with the user's key, and then have the user decrypt it with the same key. The trick is getting encrypted sessions between the user and the services. Remember, they don't have any firm shared keys. Well, how does the KAT do it? The critical piece to remember is that each principal trusts that anything encrypted with its private key comes from the KAT. So if the user can present the service with a packet encrypted with the service's private key, the service knows that this user was authenticated by the KAT and can be trusted. Let's take a look at how the whole process works, beginning with the initial logout. It's morning, and our user has just logged into his computer and entered his username and password into the login screen. The packet traveling to the KAT contains the user's name, but it does not contain the password. That's the security problem we're trying to solve. This packet is a request for a ticket granting ticket, or TGT. You need a valid ticket to access a resource because it proves your identity. The user principal will eventually use this TGT to receive tickets for all of the services it wants to access. And the person sitting at the computer will never see it happen. As part of the security of Kerberos, tickets do expire, so there are always timestamps. The KAT looks at its user principal database and confirms that this user is indeed a valid user. The KAT then creates the ticket granting ticket. This contains the user's name, the KAT name, the client's IP address, and a new key called the session key. The session key is a time-sensitive encryption key that the KAT generates just for this session. We have to change those session keys periodically in case an intruder captures our packets and tries to decrypt our encryption key. Then all of this information is encrypted using the KAT's private key, so the client never actually sees the contents of the TGT. The KAT then sends back a packet containing two things: the ticket granting ticket and another copy of the session key, which is encrypted with the user's private key. The client uses its private key based on the password that the user typed in when he sat down this morning to log in to open the service key. So what's the point of sending the client a TGT when the client is unable to read its contents? Well, watch what the client does when it wants to request a service. The client first creates an authenticator. This includes the client's name, the IP address of his computer, and the time. It encrypts the authenticator with the session key it just received from the KAT. Then it creates a packet that contains the still unopened TGT, the authenticator, and the name of the requested service, and sends this packet to the KAT. When the KAT receives this packet, it can decrypt the TGT, and knowing that it can't have been falsified because it hasn't been opened, the KAT uses the TGT to check the information in the authenticator. Now that the KAT is ready to trust the identity of the user, the KAT can send a service ticket to the client. The service ticket is particular to the requested service and only works for this user for a set period of time. The service ticket includes the username, the service name, the IP address from the client computer, and a new session key. Then the KAT encrypts this ticket with the service's private key. Note that the client does not have the service's private key and cannot modify the contents of this ticket. The KAT places a copy of the new session key and the service ticket into a packet and encrypts the whole thing with the first session key it shared with the user. And the KAT sends this back to the client. The client encrypts the packet and uses the new session key to encrypt a new authenticator and sends it to the service. The service uses its private key to open the service ticket and is guaranteed that the ticket came from the KAT because no one else has that key. Then it uses the new session key it finds there to open the authenticator. The service uses the information in the service ticket to verify the information in the authenticator. Now that it has verified the identity of the user, the service sends back an acknowledgement and the user is authenticated to the service. now thank the Kerberos who just solved three problems. We have more secure authentication, simplified management of passwords, and the convenience of single sign-on.